Let us move to another property of laser, that is coherence. So we know that the coherence exists between two light waves when they maintain same crust to crust or trap to trap correspondence. That means if the waves, they are in phase or they maintain same or constant phase difference, then that waves, that light waves are called as coherent. In case of conventional light sources, the light coming from the conventional sources is consist of a jumble of light waves. All these waves, they are not in phase. The mixture of these light waves gives rise to the incoherent light. In the case of lasers, what we have is the light coming from the laser is due to the transitions of atoms, that atoms going from the excited state to the ground state, and in this process it emits the light. In this case, due to the process of stimulated emission in the laser, all the waves coming out of the laser, they are in phase. If we see the light waves coming from the ordinary conventional sources, the light waves, they are having different wavelengths or frequencies, and because of that, what we have is incoherent light, right? So this is incoherent light. In case of laser, what we have is all the light waves, they are in phase or they maintain the same constant phase difference, and because of that, the light waves coming from laser, they are coherent. So the coherence requires that there is connection between the amplitude and the phase of the wave at one point of time, and the amplitude and phase at later point of time. So accordingly, we distinguish two classes of coherence, namely temporal coherence and spatial coherence. Temporal coherence and spatial coherence. They are also called as longitudinal coherence and temporal coherence. So the temporal coherence refers to the constancy and predictability of the phase of the wave at a particular point when the wave travel along the path, same path at some later time. Spatial coherence refers to the phase relationship between two waves traveling side by side at the same time. Let us first study the temporal coherence. In order to understand the temporal coherence, let us consider a light wave traveling along the x direction. Let us consider the electric field of this wave at two time intervals, T1 and T2. Let the phase difference between these two time intervals be phi 1. Let us now consider at the latter time T3 and T4, the wave is so this is T3 and this is T4. So these are two latter time intervals, and we consider this T4 minus T3 is equal to T2 minus T1. So in this case, let us consider the phase difference be phi 2. Now, if this phi 1 is equal to phi 2, and it is true for any time interval of, let's say, same time interval, in that case, if it is true, then that wave is said to be coherent. So the wave is said to be coherent if the phase difference for this wave for two times having the time interval, let us say that the time interval is T, and for this case also the time interval is T. So for that time interval the phase difference is phi 2, phase difference phi 1 is equal to phi 2, then that wave is said to be coherent. If phi 1 is not equal to phi 2, then that wave is said to be incoherent. The temporal coherence is essentially a characteristic of single light wave. We know that the light emitted from an atom when it jumps from the excited level to the ground state, right? So when the atom jumps from the excited state to the ground state, it emits some photon. Let us consider that we know that the excited states having lifetime of the order of 10 raised to minus 8 second, and therefore let us say that atom is emitting a wave train of this much interval. So let us consider the wave train emitted by the atom is like this, and that wave train is having this much interval. So all the atoms in that system, they emit the similar kind of wave trains, and that wave trains forms a wave packet. So each such wave packet has this time interval of 10 raised to minus 8 second. On an average, we can say that the light wave undergoes random phase changes for 10 raised to 8 seconds. So it undergoes random phase changes for 10 raised to 8 seconds. And therefore, the temporal coherence can be expressed only for short interval of time, or we can say the short length. And therefore, this temporal coherence can be expressed in terms of quantities called as coherence length, L coherence, so that means coherence length, and coherence time, so T coherence. So basically, these two quantities, coherence length and coherence time, they give rise, they tell us that how long our wave is in temporal coherence, or how long the wave maintain the same phase difference. So the coherence length is equal to lambda square upon 2 delta lambda, where lambda is the wavelength and delta lambda bandwidth of the wave. In terms of the frequency nu, this coherence length can be written as C upon delta nu. So therefore, delta nu is the bandwidth in terms of frequency nu. So we have seen that the atoms undergoes transitions, emit wave trends, and all these wave trends, they are having finite length or finite time, and during this time these emit wave trend. So if we plot the line width for this wave trend, that line width is like this. So this is, let's say, delta nu or delta lambda, whatever unit one can use. So it is the line width. Now if I consider my light wave to be infinite, so if I consider my light wave is an infinite sine wave, so in that case what we have is, so let's say it is minus infinity to plus infinity, so what we have, we should get a single line. So our line width is very narrow, line width or bandwidth is very narrow in that case, but in practice it is not possible to produce a wave of infinite coherence length. It is because all the atoms, in the case of laser, let us consider all the atoms that undergoes transitions that emit only for shorter time intervals, and because of that these waves, they undergoes phase changes after this life time interval. Now if we consider the example of incandescent tube, so we know that incandescent tube that emit radiation in the wavelength range of 4000 to 7000 angstrom, that means it emit a white light. So for that case, let us say that wave has very short coherence length. So the coherence length of that wave is very short, and therefore we can see in that case our line width will be very broad. In the case of sodium lamp, if we consider, so sodium lamp is nearly monochromatic, it emits a wavelength of average wavelength, let's say for yellow light, that is 5893. So in that case what we get is line width of this kind, so we will have slightly larger coherence length, and we'll have this kind of line width. So this is the line width delta nu. In the case of laser, if we consider that will be like this. So in the case of laser, what we have is very narrow line width. So in terms of numbers, if I calculate the coherence length, L coherence is equal to lambda square upon 2 delta lambda. Let us consider the incandescent lamp that emit light in this wavelength range, 4000 to 7000 angstrom. So delta lambda is equal to 3000 angstrom, and average wavelength lambda we consider, it is something around 500 angstrom. So if we put these values, so it is 5000 into 10 raised to minus 10 square divided by 2 into 3000, into 10 raised to minus 10, this number comes out to be 5040 angstrom. So if we consider the coherence length for the incandescent tube, that is very small, right? If you consider example of sodium lamp, so we know that sodium lamp, so this is, let's say, incandescent tube. If I consider sodium lamp, in that case what we have, the wavelength 5890 and 5896. So we have two yellow lines having wavelengths 5890 and 5896, and the average wavelength is, so lambda will be 5893 angstrom, and line width we consider it is equal to 6 angstrom. So if I put these values, so coherent length for this case comes out to be nearly, so let us put that values, so it is 5893 into 10 raised to minus 10 square divided by 2 into 6 into 10 raised to minus 10. So this number comes out to be 0.3 millimeter. Whereas in the case of laser, if we consider example of laser, let us consider helium neon laser that having bandwidth of the order of 2 into 10 raised to minus 5 angstrom and emitting a wavelength 6328 angstrom. So wavelength is 6328 angstrom. So in that case the coherence length comes out to be, so it is 6328 into 10 raised to minus 10 square divided by 2 into 2 into 10 raised to minus 5 angstrom. So that number comes out to be 100 meter. So it is nearly equal to 100 meter, and one can say that the laser has very much high coherence length compared to that of the ordinary incandescent tube light. Let us now move to the spatial coherence. It is also called as transverse coherence. So in order to understand the spatial coherence, let us consider two light waves traveling side by side at some distance from each other. Now let us consider the phase of these two waves at time t1. So at time t1, the phases of these two waves are e1 and e2 for two different points in space. So the phases are e1 and e2. If we consider the phase difference between these two waves be 0. Let us now consider these two waves at the same points at time t2. At time t2, I am considering the same Now let us consider the phases of these two waves at time t2 at the same point. It let's say at time t2, at point p1, the phase is e3, and for this wave, at point p2, the phase is e4. Again, if the phase difference at point p1 and p2 at a later time, if it is equal to 0, then we can say that the two waves, they are spatially coherent. That means spatial coherence is essentially a characteristic over space. That means it is in the direction perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave, right? So that means if the wave is propagating in this direction, so we are measuring in the perpendicular direction, we are measuring the coherence in the perpendicular direction or transverse direction, and therefore this type of coherence is called as transverse coherence. Let us consider an example. If we have a point source, in the case of point source, what we have, let us say the wave fronts coming out from this point source, that wave front and is spherical. In that case, let us consider we have two points P1 and P2 in this time interval. So these two points having the same path difference from the source. So if our wave is coherent, spatially coherent, then the phase difference at these two points P1 and P2 will be equal to 0. In the case of large sources, it is let's say our source is some large light source, and in that case what we have, our waves, they are not in phase. For infinitely longer for longer distance from the source, what we have, let us consider two points P1 and P2. At these two points, what we have is our waves, they are not in phase. That means it is essentially a characteristic of the wave along the given area, and therefore it is called as transverse coherence. It is because we measure the coherence along the transverse direction or perpendicular direction to the direction of propagation. So light coming from the laser is both temporally and spatially coherent. This is because the light coming from the laser is due to the force transitions, that means stimulated transitions of atoms that going from the higher energy state to the lower energy state, and in that case it emits a photon, right? If one atom is emitting a photon, that emitted photon again gives rise to two photons, and these two photons, they are again identical, they are coherent. These two photons again give rise to four photons, because these two photons, they trigger two more atoms, and therefore we get four photons. So in this case, in this way the number of photons goes on multiplying, and what we have, all the photons, they are in phase, and therefore the spatial coherence or temporal coherence is maintained in the case of laser.